Hi everyone, I'm Abraham, co-host of the Theology Over Drinks podcast. Today I'm joined by River, my fellow co-host, and the content provider for the New Kingdom blog.
Hello.
Today we're going to be talking about a recent series of videos that River has done on why it's important to remain Anglican. Particularly, we're going to be talking about ways that we as normal lay Anglicans can really help the church. So, River, what are some things that your average, everyday layperson in the Anglican Church can do to help the church?
Right, so the most important thing that Anglicans can do to help the church is to pray. Now, I know that as Christians, we all know that prayer is important. The Bible tells us that prayer is important. We often hear in sermons how important prayer is. But sometimes we know that prayer is important sort of intellectually. But in our hearts, we might think, but does prayer actually work? Or we might not get round to praying very often. So what I want to say is pray more, and believe me, prayer does work. It is effective. I've seen it be effective in my life, and 2,000 years of church history will tell you countless stories of how prayer is effective. So as Anglicans, we need to be praying for the church. If there's ever anything in your life that you want to be made better, you need to be praying for it. And often as Christians, we are very good at praying for ourselves or our friends and family, but maybe we're not so much good at praying for bigger picture stuff like our countries or like our great Anglican church. So if you want to help the church, please pray for her. So how are some ways that we can pray for the church? First of all, if there's things coming up, like let's say in your diocese, there's a synod meeting, you could pray for God's guidance over that. If there's a bigger picture thing like the Lambeth Conference coming up, definitely be praying for that. But also what I do is every day I make sure to pray for my bishops. So first of all, pray for your local bishop. That's the bishop of your diocese. If you don't know who that is, make sure that you do look it up and get that name. Pray for them every day. Pray for your primate every day. So that's the archbishop of your country. And just pray for God's guidance over them, that God will help them to make the right decisions, to be bold and courageous in standing up for the truth, to be compassionate, to listen to other views, to guide the church into unity. So please pray for your bishops. Please pray for them every day. Also pray for your priest. And then moving on beyond prayer, one thing I'll just add as well is how important it is to take confession. I really think that taking confession regularly will help the church out in the long run. Now, the reason for that is a couple of things, actually. One is, if you start taking confession regularly, it will have a ripple effect, usually, and more people in the congregation will start taking confession too, because most Anglicans don't take confession, even though it's in the prayer book. And maybe one reason for that is because they don't realize that there actually is confession, or they just feel weird doing it because no one else does it. But when I started taking confession regularly at my parish, more and more people started taking it too. What that does is it teaches people, from the very act of taking confession to a priest, that there are things in our lives that are sinful and that are fallen and that need to be forgiven and absolved. And what that does is it creates this culture of saying, hey, look, we're not perfect. And there are things that, honestly, we should be a bit ashamed about. And there are things that we need to be improving on. Because one problem that people keep saying the Anglican Church has is the Anglican Church is really good with compassion and showing love and acceptance to people. It's not so good at confronting sin. And often, you know, some Anglicans can have this mentality of, oh, it's okay. You know, there's nothing sinful. God accepts you no matter what. God loves you no matter what. Yeah, I guess, you know, that's true to a degree. But of course, you know, God does have moral rules. And if we're not living up to those, that needs to be corrected. So if you're creating this culture in your parish of people saying there is, you know, things that need to be confessed, I think that could have a ripple effect throughout the church itself as well. It also means that if your parish is confessing sins to God, God is more likely to listen to your prayers and help you out as well.
Yeah, that's great. What are some other practical ways that we can affect the direction of our local church and beyond?
Yeah, right. Well, I think joining the vestry of your parish is really important, and seeing if you can become a representative of your parish at synod meetings.
For those of us who may not be fully familiar with the way the Anglican Church is structured, could you explain what vestry and synod is?
Sure, yeah. So most, I'm pretty sure all actually Anglican churches will have a vestry. So that is made up of lay people in the church. I mean, it depends on how big your parish is. It might be quite a large vestry group or might be fairly small. At our parish, I'm not entirely sure on the exact number, but, you know, we're looking at about 10 people will meet, and that's about once a month. We'll meet for practical things. So often it'll just be stuff to do with finances, you know, this is the money coming in, these are our ministries, can we afford that? It might be health and safety stuff, you know, something in the hall or the church needs to be fixed or repaired. But then also it would be to do with the direction of the church itself, its mission, its goals. So one thing that Anglicans sometimes complain about is maybe their parish is becoming less traditional, less liturgical, the worship's being more modern, and they feel that because of that, the parish is losing its Anglican identity a bit more. If you're in vestry, you could influence that direction, and you can say, actually, you know, I'd rather we were more liturgical or whatever it is, and everything at vestry gets voted on, so that's just one more vote. And that's just obviously a very practical way of helping your parish. And then beyond that, for synod, about once a year, dioceses will have a synod meeting where each parish is represented. Depends, you know, on various things. But for instance, my church, our priest always goes to synod, and so do two people from our congregation as representatives. Now, that means they get to vote on the synod meetings. So if you want to influence the direction of your diocese, obviously, you should definitely try and become a synod rep, because now you're actually voting on those decisions. Also, a synod gives you the opportunity to speak up about any bill or whatever they're trying to pass. You can actually say, stand up and say something. So that's a really obvious way to influence the church as well. But also, sometimes with synods, you know, they'll be locked on a number. So we've got our two representatives, so no one else can join. It's really important to show an interest in synod. Now, I'll just give you an example. A couple of years ago, my diocese here in Auckland had a pretty big decision, a big motion was passed that affected the church quite greatly, and quite a lot of people were upset by that motion. Now, I didn't actually hear about that motion from my representatives. I heard about it on the news because we didn't talk about it, and that's quite important. If you're a representative, you need to be telling your congregation exactly what's going on at synod and what the big motions are that got passed or rejected. And also, if they're not doing that and you're in the congregation, you know that there was just a synod meeting, maybe after the service or something, raise your hand, stand up. Hey, can we just hear from the synod representatives what happened at synod? Stay engaged and stay focused on what the church is doing. And that way more people are aware of what's happening. Because what I'm finding is, very often, the congregations of churches simply aren't aware of these big decisions that are getting made that sometimes people get upset about. So please stay aware. Try and do everything you can to stay aware and to influence those decisions.
Yeah, absolutely. In your previous video, you talked about ways that, that people should be trying to disciple each other more in church. So what are some ways that a lay person can help to disciple others in their local church?
Yeah, great. Okay, so if there are individuals in your congregation whose spiritual life isn't great, maybe they don't even come to church very often and you just sense that they're not very close to God, you could buddy up with them, mentor them, and start to get close to them and pray with them, offer to read scripture with them, etc. You know, those sorts of things. Beyond that, create Bible studies, create a prayer group. You know, so a lot of churches sadly don't actually have a Bible study or a prayer group that meets outside of the regular Sunday service. And if you don't have one and you want there to be one, well, maybe you should start one. Talk to your priest about it. Hey, we don't have a Bible study. I know a bit about the Bible. And if you don't, maybe ask your priest to help you out, do something, have that Bible study. And then you're teaching people really good biblical teachings that will influence their faith and help them to stay in the truth. Also, encourage other people to do that if you're not very comfortable about it. If there are people in your church who you know are very biblical minded and they're very passionate about God, say, hey, you know, have you ever considered starting up a Bible study? Very often people want to do something, but they don't do it simply because no one's encouraged them, and they just sort of feel, oh, I might be arrogant if I want to serve a Bible study. But if you encourage people, then they will do it. So there's that. There's evangelism. Try and evangelize people, get them into the Anglican Church. A big problem in the Anglican Church is just falling numbers, right? So we need to be evangelizing people. Very often, evangelism is about just making people Christian. Obviously, that's first and foremost the priority. But, you know, with falling numbers, we also want to be evangelizing people to become Anglican, especially young people. And then for that as well, if you've got young people in your church, I think they're the ones to focus on the most, because they are the future of the church in the sense that they will be the big leaders of the church later on. So mentor them, encourage them to evangelize, encourage them to bring their friends along. You know, if you've got high school people, say, why don't you bring your high school friends over the church? And if they don't think those high school friends will be comfortable with that, see why, and maybe the church can change a service or two to make them feel more comfortable. I don't know, just some ideas there. But evangelism, encouraging youth, Bible studies, encouraging other people to run Bible studies, all those were some ideas I'd have, yeah.
Very nice. The world we live in today is obviously dominated by the internet. It's an incredibly important tool, and well, we should be using it as a tool for helping the church. So what are some ways that we can use our online presence as a way to help the Anglican Church?
Yeah, that's a really good point, how important the internet is. We've definitely seen that during lockdown, of course. And I think the internet's also a big area that makes people leave the Anglican Church, because in my experience, looking at especially like Facebook groups, lots of Anglican groups there is a very strong presence of people who have left the Anglican Church who will try and get people to leave as well. I see it on a daily basis. When I upload my videos and the videos that we do, Abraham, with Theology Over Drinks, and we put them in Facebook groups or whatnot, there's often a lot of backlash from people who've already left the church saying, you should leave too, etc. And what I'm finding is there isn't a very strong presence pushing back on that, of being pro-Anglican, defending the church. It's just about every time I see anyone talk about Anglicanism in Christian circles online, it's negative. Would you say that's the same in your experience?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
So try and be a voice that is for the Anglican Church. You know, so in a broad sense, I'd say the most important thing to do online is to be proud that you are an Anglican. Seriously, just be proud of it. Say, I'm an Anglican, and I'm proud to be. And, you know, people might laugh at you, mock you, whatever, you know. I'm proud to be an Anglican. So there's that. There's supporting Anglican podcasts and YouTube channels, of course. So, you know, there's the Sacramentalist podcast. There's Barely Protestant. There's a YouTube channel called Maple Anglican. They haven't made videos in a wee while, I think, but they are a really good channel. So those are just some off the top of my head you could check out. And then another just a simple step is just don't speak ill of the Anglican Church. You know, a lot of people talk negatively about it. You know, most of what we see about Anglicanism online is criticizing it, mocking it, whatever. Just make sure you don't catch yourself do that. You know, we want people to realize that there are still things about Anglicanism. In fact, the vast majority of things about Anglicanism are things to be proud of, and to be respected. And yeah, just make sure you speak about those and you don't talk about the issues as much. Talk about the issues with fellow Anglicans, maybe, but yeah, maybe not so much with non-Anglicans. Yeah.
So what are any other, you know, day-to-day ways that we can help out in the church?
Yeah, I think one last thing I'd like to talk about, I know, you know, Christians, we hear this all the time as well. Maybe not so much in Anglican churches, though. This is the sort of thing that big sort of Pentecostal churches will talk about all the time, and it shows. And that's donating to your church, or tithing. You see the big, you know, Pentecostal churches where they'll have a sermon on tithing, like scheduled once a month or something. You can tell because those churches tend to be quite wealthy. Anglican churches sometimes are not wealthy. And I think a big reason for that is we don't feel, it's just not in our culture as Anglicans to talk about it. I've actually never heard a sermon at my church about the importance of tithing or donating. It just doesn't get talked about. And I get why they don't want to talk about it. You don't want to become, you know, that guy or that girl who's always talking about spending money and giving the church money or whatever. But it is important because a big thing in the church is that a lot of churches just get shut down. And it's because simply they run out of money, and it's tragic. I know a priest quite well here in Auckland. His church had to close, just dwindling numbers, but also running out of money. You know, there aren't enough people paying the church, donating to the church. So there isn't enough money to pay the priest or to pay for these ministries, and that's really tragic. So, you know, I know as Christians we don't like talking about money, but money is sadly what pays the bills and what makes the world go round. So we do need to be more generous to our churches. So that's an important point to make, I think.
Absolutely. Well, thank you, River, for giving these practical steps that we can take in our day-to-day lives to help the Anglican Church. We hope that everyone has enjoyed the video and can get something out of this. Hopefully, you'll be able to action some of these in your day-to-day life. And hopefully I'll be able to see you soon, River, for some talks about theology and maybe a couple of drinks.
Yeah, looking forward to it. Thank you for interviewing me today.
Absolutely. Anytime.
Well, God bless.
God bless.
See ya.